Thanks. So my name is Eugene. I'm a front-end engineer at Yahoo Search, and I'm on the Access team, a member of the Access team. I've been at Yahoo for about 5 years now. I joined Search about a year ago. About a year ago, just in time to kick off the Access project, which was one of the first to use the Cocktails platform and Node.js at Yahoo. Today, I'm going to talk about the YUI Communication Layer, which was developed to facilitate communication between all the sandboxed applications that Kuriti was talking about. This module was open sourced just last week, so you can find it in the YUI gallery under Gallery Communication Layer. Okay, so before we jump in, I just wanted to clarify that the YUI Communication Layer is also known as CL for short. So hopefully nobody gets thrown off by that. And in case you haven't, well, you have seen it in the introduction, this is Yahoo Access. It's currently available on the desktop as an extension for Chrome, Safari, Firefox, and IE. And it's also available in the App Store for the iPhone and iPad with Android on the roadmap. So this is basically a paradigm shift where we start thinking of Search as a companion instead of as a destination. And it follows you from page to page and stays minimized until you need it. So for example, let's say you're being productive on reddit.com and you want to look up the weather. All you need to do is search for it and you don't have to leave the page that you're on. Or let's say you wanted to find an image. You could also do that without having to leave the page. The idea is pretty simple. When you search for something, you get back search results as a list of swipeable cards. And your search session and bookmarks are syncable, so you can pick up where you left off from any of your supported devices. So Access is composed of multiple sandboxed Mojito applications, which all have different domains. You can think of it as a tree of documents, where each node corresponds to an iframe or a web view, and each edge corresponds to a CL connection. So let's quickly introduce each application, and then hopefully you'll have better context about this application before I start talking about CL. The Access application is effectively the root node of the tree of documents that I just talked about. The only UI that it owns is highlighted in red over here. It's what we call the Omnibar. It's 35 pixels tall. And based on the user interaction with this Omnibar, we dynamically load other applications which bring other features to the table. So this area we call the search layer application, and it responds to what the user types into the input and displays visual results followed by algorithmic results in the form of swipeable cards that you can just swipe through, and additional cards are loaded on demand as you swipe. This component exists in its own iframe on the desktop and in a web view in the native iOS app. So we'll get to more details about that later. The part outlined in red here is the bookmark application. It's also in its own iframe. It was mainly developed by a remote team in Beijing, which we'll also talk a little bit about later. And it allows you to bookmark pages that you visit often or you want to read later with a simple click. So this is the image viewer application, and the area highlighted in red is its own iframe with the image viewer loaded inside. And although it may not look like it, this is actually created and destroyed as an iframe within the search layer component that I showed you earlier. So in the future, we'll have like a video app in the same vein as this image app. So please look forward to that. So there are a lot of benefits to sandboxing, like we did for Access. The first benefit was in minimizing the overhead and working or collaborating with remote teams. After we initially defined and documented the communication that we would have to do with the bookmark application, we didn't have to spend as much, as many nights syncing up with the Beijing engineers because of the strict sandboxing that we had in place. Another benefit of breaking these pieces down into Mojito applications was that we were able to minimize the scope of QA for new releases. So we still have to do integration testing when we push, but we can focus our QA efforts on the pieces that actually changed. And the next two benefits have more to do with the way that we designed Access than the sandboxing itself. What we do is we create the component when it's needed, and we destroy the component after it's served its purpose. In this way, we're able to minimize the memory footprint of the application because users don't need a fully functional instance of Access in each tab. This would be especially a big problem for users who tend to keep a bunch of tabs open. And we all know somebody who, keeps 100 tabs open in their browser. So you also get the benefit of sandboxing memory leaks that are pretty much to be expected. When you're dealing with a potentially long-running widget like Access, for example, if you have your email open in a tab, chances are you're going to keep it open the whole day. And even a small memory leak eventually just keeps building up and becomes a big problem. So we effectively nip these kind of issues in the bud by simulating a traditional website where a user moves on after they've finished consuming the content. And we destroy applications once they've fulfilled their purpose. This last feature will probably be even more important if we add support for third-party apps, which is also on the roadmap. So here's the list of all the components in Access today that I covered. They're all sandboxed in their own iframe or WebView. And as a consequence of breaking Access up into multiple components with different document origins, we need to deal with the problem of the same origin policy before we can freely communicate among the applications. So these are a couple of examples of workarounds that people have used over the years. Now, the first one involves modifying document.domain to relax the security policy between two iframes with the precondition that one iframe is a subdomain of the other. And the next two are pretty much just clever hacks that involve polling and a shared workspace where you can read and write messages. Well, it's not pretty. We decided to go with PostMessage, which is an HTML5 cross-document messaging model. That means it was created for the explicit purpose of allowing communication between documents regardless of their source domain. And this is a partial list of browsers that support PostMessage. And as you can see, it's pretty much available in all the modern browsers, both on the desktop and on mobile. If you're a developer that uses PostMessage, authentication checks are completely left up to you. As you can see in the first example, PostMessage lets you dispatch messages to any domain, regardless of the origin. This isn't secure because the origin of a window may have changed, maybe due to an XSS attack, and all the messages that get sent out may end up being intercepted by a malicious document. With every incoming message, you get the window reference, also known as the source, the origin of the document, and the event data. And if you're dealing with sensitive data, you always want to check the origin of the message. Even if the data isn't sensitive, authenticating the message before doing any potentially expensive operations can help prevent denial of service attacks. So it's a good practice to do this all the time. The communication layer handles authentication for you. And after the parent document has registered the iframe, it receives a proxy object that can be used to subscribe to events and to fire events on. All authentication checks happen transparently, so the iframe you're working with has its source, if it has its source attribute changed at any point after you registered it, the proxy is rendered is automatically invalidated. And we have the same idea when we look at it from the perspective of the child. The main difference here is that we interact with the CL instance directly. Since you can only have one parent in a document, you don't need to instantiate multiple proxy objects for messages going up. I should also mention here that the CL API is essentially exactly the same as the YUI custom event API, which makes it really intuitive to use, especially if you're a YUI developer. So the CL also lets you sync the initialization of your apps, which is a problem like Karidi mentioned earlier. The parent can define a callback which executes once the child signals to the parent that it's ready. This is modeled after the YUI DOM ready event and makes use of the fire once configuration if you're familiar with publishing events. And after the child has signaled readiness, any subsequent calls to the ready method will execute the callback immediately. This prevents entering any weird undefined states due to things like an important lifecycle event that was missed. So when you fire an event into the CL, the sender can define a callback that can be invoked by the receiver of the message in a separate iframe. So in this example here, you can request the Base64 encoded version of an image in case you needed that in your application. And the receiver would encode that URL. Remember, this is in a separate iframe. And then pass that encoded data back through the callback facade. So as was alluded to earlier, all our apps can run in an iframe or a web view without having to know which one it's running in. If you think about it, all it's doing is communicating with other apps by sending and receiving messages. So the difference between an iframe and a web view should be abstracted out by whatever communication layer that's in place. And CL is structured in a way that only requires three methods to be overridden. The first one is init parent connection. This one defines how you initialize a connection with the parent. The second one is on parent message event. This one defines how to receive messages from the parent. And the third one is fire parent message event. And it basically defines how you send messages to the parent. And so in practice, we've done this with the CL iOS, which is the CL instance that we use to communicate when we're inside a web view. And it's been working pretty well, and it's very simple. So Karidi did an interesting analysis using JSPerf to test the performance of PostMessage, as well as what kind of overhead the CL wrapper brings with it. So an operation here is defined as a Marco Polo round trip, where one component says Marco, and the other component replies with Polo. So for example, Chrome is able to do 478 round trips using a post message, and 410 round trips using the CL. As you can see, there's somewhat of a noticeable overhead, but it's not too bad when you think about it in terms of how many times or how many milliseconds it takes for a single round trip. In fact, for most browsers, a CL round trip takes less time than the browser timer resolution, which is commonly set to 4 milliseconds today. So if you were so inclined, you could actually do JavaScript animation through the CL, and you wouldn't be able to tell. Like, there would be no performance overhead, in theory. Like, I haven't tried that, but. So I'd also like to point out here that the CL actually serializes a JavaScript object every time you send a message and parses that JSON JSON when it comes back in. So there's kind of an overhead associated with CL messages that isn't being considered here in PostMessage, because you're just sending a simple string. And assuming that your application is complex enough that you're going to be doing this stringifying and parsing anyway, the performance gap is probably less than what's indicated here. And we have a similar scenario for mobile browsers. One thing to note here was that there was a huge performance increase between iOS 4 and iOS 5, as you can see from the iPad numbers. And the iPhone numbers were very, very similar. A round trip on iOS 4 iPad takes 18 milliseconds, but this hasn't really been an issue for Axis, as far as we can tell, probably because the 3G bottleneck is orders of magnitudes worse. And the fact that PostMessage itself is slow on iOS 4 is something to keep in mind when designing your application architecture in the context of mobile. So if you're interested in more detail around this, these performance numbers, check out Caridi's article called PostMessage Performance Analysis. It has a lot more numbers than the ones I included in my slides, and it's really interesting to see how fast browsers are improving. So a couple of points before I wrap this up. Consider iframes as a sandboxing technique to break complex applications down into manageable pieces. Consider using the CL to stitch together these pieces. It's been working great for Axis, and we'll most likely be adding more features as the product matures. It's actually already being used outside of Axis, so it's been proven to be reusable. Consider simplifying your cross-document communications with additional features, like the callback facades, transparent authentication, the free serialization of data that you get, and the intuitive YUI custom event API. And consider abstracting out specific transport methods, so you can add custom bridges or legacy transports for older browsers, and your application logic never has to change. And again, you can find the CL in the YUI gallery under the module name Gallery Communication Layer. Feel free to take advantage of all the effort we've been putting into this piece. And that's all I have today. Thank you.